But when you say MPhil, it has Master of Philosophy. There's a term called philosophy in the title which I got. But I really don't know the meaning of that term philosophy. To be frank, actually, without knowing, the name embedded inside my degree title, I got it. Okay? I think that applies to most of our colleagues and friends and students also. So then, but I got some idea this doing a research is basically discovering knowledge. So then that part I understood. But I didn't know any connection with doing a research and philosophy. I was basically interested. I realized, okay, doing a research is very much to do with some discovering of some kind of new knowledge. So in 1992, after my MPhil, I went to UK, University of Kiel, for my PhD. But I never disclosed the fact that I did know the term philosophy to my supervisor there. So when I go there, actually again I had to live with this unknown term philosophy. I didn't know that term. More seriously, actually, I was working in the field of artificial intelligence, where when we talk about this modeling of intelligence, knowledge, and all these things, philosophy happened to be one of the most influential area for AI. Then I don't have any excuse to tell that I don't know the real meaning of this word philosophy. So then I had to do a lot of studies about philosophy, then this basically where the knowledge came from, whether we can model the knowledge, whether we can transfer the knowledge, all kind of actually philosophical thoughts. The substance in AI had been thought by philosophers long time before the artificial intelligence people. So then, because of this reason, actually, I started to read about the subject of philosophy again. So then, it's very interesting. One day, when I was at the bus stop for waiting for my bus, I met a lecturer from philosophy department from same university. Okay. So he was longly there. So then I just approached him and start talking, but we did not talk about philosophy. But because of the pressure I had, automatically or naturally it came out of my mouth that what is this philosophy and that kind of question. He gave me a very nice answer. Straight away he said that philosophy is the one which actually guides the discovery of all kind of knowledge. Without philosophical thoughts, unless the philosopher come and guide the scientists, actually scientists cannot find new directions. So there should be kind of philosophical change, or the way you think, the way you approach, the way you look at something, so then only scientists can go forward. Okay, so with that actually knowledge, later on I used that one. I was talking to my student that now we are talking about this solar energy. So we are still using these solar cells, but we cannot come up with something fruitful. Efficiency of these solar cells are very low. So now actually scientists may need different way to think of how we can exploit the solar energy in a more effective manner. So then thinking that in a different way. So then that is where the main idea of philosophy comes into our scientific realm according to its explanation. But when you look at these plants and all other things, you can see these leaves of the plants are the best example of the best solar cells, because they know how to get the maximum energy from sunlight and do this photosynthesis and all kind of complicated process. So then this world is full of examples where solar energy can be effectively used, given by the plants, but we are still unable to develop solar cells, to develop kind of device to extend. So then this kind of ideas actually, so then scientists at one point will stuck. They will stop because they cannot go. Only the philosophers can come and give some new thoughts about where you can go. So then, again, in a very general sense, I also gathered that in any philosophy, you will find some assumptions are there. Any system of knowledge, you have that. So some foundation is there. Later on, actually, I realized when I was giving presentations in my MPhil and so on, what is the basis of your thesis? So then without the basis, actually, you cannot have a philosophy. So there should be a foundation. So then again, actually, you discover or invent some methods. And some implications are there for the real world because of these findings. So then all these things actually went to my mind. And this particular lecturer from philosophy department is happened to be very interested in this morning. I wanted to download the photograph of at least the Department of Philosophy, University of Kiel, for my presentation purpose. When I did a Google search and went there, there's a message saying that Kiel University has decided to close down the philosophy department there. Because even at that time, these departments were not very popular, not a lot of demands and so on. Otherwise, I would have not been able to catch that person in the bus stop. Because somehow, anyway, I could not trace that person again. So then, actually, I still can remember some of the nice example he gave me at the bus stop in relation to this philosophical discussions there. I don't know how many of you have seen this very interesting thing about logic. Okay? When you do logic, the situation that we define the truth table to give the semantic for this logical expression, where this false implies false is defined as true. So it's a bit of unacceptable thing when you look at the real world thing. If you say that elephants can fly, then it implies fish can walk. So that the conclusion is true according to this definition. But we are actually going by the definition. Right? So then he explained to me what is the importance of this fantastic construction. So then now when you take the truth table for this particular moment, we have this concept of equivalences. We know that P implies Q and not P or Q are equivalent. Then both are having the same truth table. So the equivalence in the sense, instead of whenever you want to have whenever you have P implies Q, instead of that you can use not P or Q. So then you can see here the truth value assignments for these two columns are the same. So then if you can replace one thing from the another, our common sense is that it has to be a total. Otherwise, how can you take not P or Q instead of P implies Q? So it forms a tautology. Then you can see P implies Q imply not P or Q is a tautology. So then when you go to second row, if you do not define false implies false as true, you cannot get the tautology out of equivalences. So then the whole system of logic will fail. Even though it appears to be a bit of odd thing in the real world experience, equivalences will not be tautologies if you don't define false implies false as true. So very interesting thing. So then I did my first degree in mathematics. At that time I didn't know this, to be frank. Even after doing my MPhil and all other studies, then logic I did for artificial intelligence also, I never realized this. Actually, this is a kind of thing that we normally do not take very seriously when we learn subjects. So in mathematics, this very interesting idea was there. So then I was really fascinated when I hear this particular information, and when I share that my thoughts sometime later with my mathematics students and then lecturers also, we just remember that false implies false is true, but we never thought why it should be defined that way. Otherwise, entire system of logic will break. So you don't have a subject called logic today if you don't define this false implies false as true. Okay. Another interesting thing that he gave me, I will leave it for you to figure it out. There is something called the famous chain rule. Okay. If baby is dead, then baby does not cry. If baby does not cry, then mother is happy. What is your conclusion?
Kill the baby.